The Lord be with you. Welcome to this time of worship that has been carved out for you. Whether you're worshiping during the 10 o'clock hour, like so many of our congregation and friends do, or perhaps later in the week, right before bed or early in the morning, or on a break at work, wherever you are and whenever you are, we welcome you to this time where God is present. This is the second Sunday of Advent, and so we are taking our journey closer and closer to the celebration of the birth of our Lord Jesus the Christ. And so this Sunday, the word for our Advent journey is peace. And so I do pray that whether while in this time of worship, or maybe during your week, maybe in a surprising time, may God's peace reach you this week. Let us now breathe in the very breath of God and allow our God to call us into this very sacred time of worship. Let us worship God.
Watch and wait, for Christ is coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God. Today is the second Sunday of Advent. We rejoice in the great gift that is ours in Jesus Christ by lighting the candles of the Advent wreath, signifying that Jesus is the light of the world.
Lighting a candle is a simple yet profound testimony to the power of light over darkness. Each week, we not only light one more candle in our wreath, we also light one more row of pew candles, which represent the progress of our journey from darkness to light. Here's Zechariah's song of hope for peace from the Gospel of Luke. You, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace.
The evergreens which surround the Advent candles remind us that Christ is life eternal and that he brings life to us. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of hope. On this second Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of peace, which some also call Bethlehem candle. Jesus Christ is our peace. Christ comes to bring justice, wholeness, harmony, and peace to every relationship throughout all creation. May we inspire the world with peace and live as peacemakers. May we feel the presence of peace easing our hearts and transforming our lives. May we share the healing power of peace and with our children, and that they might become the inspiration through which peace makes its way to a renewed world.
As we add the peace ornaments to the tree, let us walk in the light of our Lord. Jesus Christ is our peace, today and forever. May peace light the world this Christmas.
Thank you, Pastor Erica. Now please join me in our call to worship. I am a messenger, says the Lord, to prepare the way before me. And even now, a voice is crying out, prepare the way of the Lord.
Amen.
Join me to our call to confession from Isaiah chapter 64, verses 6 through 9. We have all sinned. Not one of us is clean, but there is mercy for those who call on the name of the Lord. So please join me in the prayer of confession. Eternal God, we confess that we resist your holy realm. You seek justice and righteousness, but we pursue selfish agendas. You promise us salvation, and we trust in our own strength. Oh, forgive us, God of grace. Lead us in your way of truth so that we may be ready to see you face to face. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Every valley is lifted up, every mountain made low. Now the glory of the Lord is revealed, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen, amen, amen.
Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us then forgive one another and pass the peace of Christ to each other. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. My dear friends, as I say each week, be sure to express the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ to those with whom you are worshiping, and also throughout the week, in a handwritten note or an email or a text or a phone call. May we accept the calling as Christians to spread the peace of Christ to all those whom we may meet. And may the light of your candle in your room, in your sanctuary, be a reminder to you of the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Lord God, pour out your Spirit upon us to bring good news to the oppressed. And let your words be filled among us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our first scripture reading comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Let us hear the word of the Lord. Comfort. O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Verse 5. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all the people shall see it together, from the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Verse 6. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? all people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the Lord's breath blows upon it. Surely, the people are still grass. Verse 8, yes, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God still stands forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good things. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up. Do not fear, say the cities of Judah. Here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. Verse 11 says, he will feed his flock like a shepherd. Isn't that beautiful? He will feed his flock like a shepherd, and he will gather the lambs in his arms. So comforting, isn't it? And carry them in his bosom, and gently lead the mother sheep.
I have traveled many moonless nights, cold and weary, with a babe inside, and I wonder what I've done. Holy Father, in a silent prayer, I am frightened by the load I bear. In a world as cold as stone, must I walk this path alone? Be me now, be with me now. Breath of heaven, hold me together, be forever near me. Breath of heaven, breath of heaven, light in my darkness, pour over me your holiness, for your holy breath of heaven. Do you wonder as you walk my face, if a wiser one should have had my place, but I offer all I am for the mercy of your plan. Help me me be strong. Help me be. Help me. Breath of heaven, hold me together. Be forever near me. Breath of heaven. Breath of heaven, lighten my darkness.
Our second lesson this morning comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. And if you have your Advent devotionals there at home with you, the very first page of our second week that says, to bring peace, it has the scripture right there for you. So you might choose to keep that scripture maybe by your bed or at your table so that you can read at mealtimes. Let us now read the Gospel according to Luke, verses 46 to 55. Listen now for the word of God. And Mary said, my soul proclaims your greatness, O God, and my spirit rejoices in you, my Savior. For you have looked with favor upon your lowly servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For you, the Almighty, have done great things for me, and holy is your name. Your mercy is for those who fear you from generation to generation. You have shown strength with your arm. You have scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. You have brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. You filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. You have helped your servant Israel in remembrance of mercy, according to the promise you made to our ancestors, to Sarah and Abraham and to their descendants forever. This is the word of the Lord. Frederick Buechner, who was a Presbyterian theologian, pastor, preacher, writer of both fiction and nonfiction, and even some autobiographical works. Frederick Buechner says this, as he tries to imagine what the coming together of Gabriel and Mary might have been like in the scripture that we read last week. He writes this. She struck the angel Gabriel as hardly old enough to have a child at all, let alone this child. But he'd been entrusted with a message to give her, and he gave it to her. He told her what the child was to be named and who he was to be and something about the mystery that was to come upon her. "You mustn't be afraid, Mary," he said. As he said it, he only hoped she wouldn't notice that beneath the great golden wings, he himself was trembling with fear to think that the whole future of creation hung now on the answer of a girl. She was the unlikely. Buechner writes with poetry and prose so that we can somewhat get into the mind and the thought processes of the angel Gabriel looking at this young child, the child herself who was to bear this child. And Buechner imagines that Gabriel stood in that silence, aware that the salvation of humankind depended on her answer. And last week we spoke about her answer. She was the unlikely, and she knew it. And this Magnificat, as it is referred to, because the Latin for magnifies, this great prayer has been sung in so many languages. And it speaks about the role reversal, the unlikely. Because even Mary's relatives that she had gone to stay with, and some people believe that perhaps Luke intended that it's written that she prayed this prayer when she was at Zechariah's and Elizabeth's. Why, they were descended from those who were great in Israel's history, but Mary was just Mary. And she knew it. And that's why she prayed this prayer and spoke this proclamation that those who were lowly will be brought up high, and those who are sitting in lofty places might have to be brought low. And this is why when those in the holy, well, not the holy then, but the those in the Roman Empire that had then became the Holy Roman Empire, and that is why when those in the Roman Empire became Christian, there was a decision to celebrate Christmas at this time of year. Because most historians, most biblical historians, put the birth of Jesus somewhere in April, in the spring. And yet it made sense to celebrate Christmas during this time that the Romans had always celebrated as Saturnalia, which traditionally happened between the 17th and the 23rd of December. And this was a time where in families and in villages and in communities, those who were the servants got to be kings for a day. And those who were in charge had to become, or maybe were given the gift of knowing what it means to serve. And so Mary speaks this role reversal. And so when those Romans became Christian, they saw a lot of these writings within the scripture, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. This poor babe in a manger who actually is the King of Kings, this role reversal, this turning the world on its head. And to quote Hamilton, the world turned upside down. Why, in reading these scriptures, it made the most sense to celebrate the birth of Christ during this time where the culture was already accustomed to having the world turned upside down. Erica Marksberry, who writes for our devotion, reflects correctly on the fact that here Mary is quoting her ancestor of faith, and that's Hannah. Hannah in 1 Samuel, who thought that she couldn't have a baby, why she conceived Samuel, who became the one to anoint the kings, and when she cried out to her God, why there is a great similarity. If you could look at that prayer, it's Mary is quoting from Hannah, and she's quoting from the Psalms. And so she is speaking the prophecy of her people. And as I read in a sermon this week, there is this understanding in the Old Testament and Old Testament scholars of the prophetic perfect tense. Do you see that? How Mary is speaking prophecy of something that will happen, but she's speaking about it as if it had already happened. That's the prophetic perfect, because it's in this timeline that really has no time. It's in the past, it's in the present, it's in the future. And so she's speaking this prophetic perfect that had already been spoken by the people of faith, her ancestors of faith. And then she gives it to us to speak to our children as we teach our children of the traditions of Christmas. She's referring to herself, and yet, as many people have reflected, she doesn't say, "Oh, dear God, thank you so much for lifting me up." She says, she speaks about those who are lifted up in community. She looks around herself. And as we are focusing on this word peace and this understanding of peace, the way that Erica Marksberry, how she reflects on peace in her writing, the peace that comes from surprise and delight. Mary doesn't just hoard that peace for herself. Why, she shares it with everyone else. And if you think about it very literally, in the time that Mary was living, there was a small percentage of those in her community and her wider region that could have been referred to as rich. And the rest were poor. Hungry, poor. And so this role reversal was something that she wanted to share with everyone else. This peace. Erica Marksberry writes about it, that the injustice in her community meant a deep peace wasn't possible for any of them. And so she proclaims the magnificence of God. Not just a magnificence that is for her, just herself. No, Christmas isn't a private holiday. It is a community holiday. It is a holiday for the entire body of Christ. And even though we're not going to be celebrating it in community in the way that we
usually do. Why, in every spiritual way and in every way possible, we will remember in this Advent and in this Christmas that the peace that comes from the birth of Jesus the Christ is for the community, is for the body of Christ. This role reversal. Maybe the peace that actually comes from learning what it means to be a servant. The peace that comes from actually being saved from our own powering over. That peace that comes from, as Marksberry writes, having our bellies full for the first time in a long time. That peace that comes when, do you know this one? When we've been grieving for so long, we had forgotten what it felt like to feel peace. And then maybe we do for a minute or two. God will surprise you in that way. That is the surprise of the Magnificat. Just when we feel like despair will reign, God will offer a glimpse, a glimmer, or maybe even a beacon of hope. But it won't happen all of the time. Then it wouldn't be surprising. Then it wouldn't be mysterious. Then we wouldn't have to slow down a little bit like we do during Advent to focus upon our God. Then we wouldn't have to carve out this time for worship and prayer. If it weren't surprising, if it weren't unique. But it's possible. The prophetic perfect tense that Mary speaks and quotes from her faithful ancestors, that God's mercy is for those who fear God from generation to generation. That prophetic perfect that was true for Abraham and Sarah and for Hannah and the psalmist and for Mary is true for us because of Jesus the Christ. I pray that you will be surprised by peace this week, this Advent, and this Christmas. May it be true for you, and may you be delightfully surprised. Amen.
Let us read together in unison our affirmation of faith. We believe in one God, who is creator, maker of all we see and all we don't see, who is ruler of the universe, source of all creation. We believe in one God who is Jesus Christ, God from God, light from light, true God and true human. He is one with the Creator, the Word made flesh, our Messiah, Savior of all creation. We believe in one God, the who is Holy Spirit, breath of God moving among us, who is one with the Creator, one with Christ, our Comforter and our Guide, Mentor of all creation.
My dear friends, we now have the opportunity to respond to God's good work and good words by giving of our talents, our tithe, our gifts. And as always, when we're online or even in person, you are welcome to send your offering in the form of a check in the mail, or you can also use the PayPal link that is found on our website, which is www.fpcmicity.org. My dear friends, we give from our joy, we give from our peace, we give from our hope. Let us now respond to God's good word now with our gifts. Let us now pray. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for the sacrifice and the hope and the joy that has gone into the giving of these gifts. And we ask that you might call us to use these gifts to further your ministry, your mission that you have called us, to share your love as we welcome, worship, celebrate, and serve. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. I don't have very many concerns of the church. You know that we are still celebrating Advent next week and the week after, and we will be celebrating Christmas Eve, most likely from our homes. The recorded service will be sent to you at 7 o'clock on Christmas Eve, and so we will worship as we always have at that time. This morning, I'm excited to tell you that our two first graders were not satisfied to hear that they would have to wait until we were all back in person, kids and all, to get their worship milestone. Because they know that in first grade, they're supposed to receive their worship milestone. It's the time when they're no longer to go to the nursery. They're to sit in worship until right after the sermon to when they would go to Sunday school during normal times. They're now old enough to be the youth liturgist. And I gave them a tutorial yesterday about all the different parts of worship and the furniture that we have up here, and they learned all of these specific names for each piece, and they learned all about worship. This is their worship milestone. And just like the first graders on, from 2016 on, they will receive the Spark Story Bible. And this is the Bible that they will read the stories of their faith. And so just like Mary was given the stories of her faith and reflected it, we're doing the same for our children. So, Jerry and Annabelle, would you come and stand by the baptismal font? I taught that to you yesterday. So the last milestone that you received, there you go. The last milestone that you received was your baptism milestone. And now that you're in first grade, you are welcome to be in worship the entire time with us. And we know that you've been learning how to worship even at home. So the two of you have written something that you have elected to read to the congregation. So now I'm going to ask you to go back to where you were. Each first grader, to attain their, come on, Jerry, to attain their worship milestone is to finish this sentence. My favorite part of worship is?
Mom's.
Oh, you could say the whole thing. Remember, you're supposed to say your name and what grade you're in and how old you are. Remember.
I'm 7 years old.
Start over. My name is?
My name is Jerry. I'm 7 years old and I'm in first grade. And my favorite part of worship is Mom's sermons. My name is Annabelle. And I'm 7 years old and I'm in fourth grade. And my favorite part of worship is the singing.
Okay, now you can come back over to the baptismal font. I did things kind of out of order. So I'm going to pray for both of you, and then you're going to get a surprise. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your word and the opportunity to share your word from generation to generation. As Mary said in the Magnificat, to tell of your mercy to generation to generation. And so we thank you for these two first graders who have worked diligently to learn about the worship of you and will learn more as they read in their Bibles. I thank you for this congregation that continues to live into the baptismal covenant for these two children and for all of the children of the church. Gracious God, we ask that you continue to grow each one of us in our faith. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. And so, since Jerry got to go first to read his speech, Annabelle, I have a surprise for you. I actually have your actual stone to put in your faith box. And your very own Bible, not that one, your very own Bible that you can now, as you are learning to read in the first grade, you can now read and have read to you at home. And Jerry, here is your worship milestone to put in your faith box with your baptism milestone and waiting for all the others that will come all the way through to your high school graduation. And here is your Spark Story Bible, where as you're learning to read, you can read the stories of your faith and have them read to you at home. May God bless you. Peace be with you both. My dear friends, we hear in Scripture that they will come from east and west and north and south to sit at table with the people of God. And so I welcome you to this communion table and to the tables in your homes as we celebrate as one congregational family. And as I remind us so many Sundays, this is not a Michigan City table or even a Presbyterian table, and it sure isn't my table. This table is of the Lord Jesus Christ, and Jesus the Christ is the host of this meal, and I am merely serving here to serve you and to serve God. And so I ask that we share together in the great prayer of thanksgiving. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Eternal God, holy and mighty, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord, our God, creator and ruler of the universe. We thank you for your creation. We thank you that you have created us in your image. And even when we rebelled against your image, you sent prophets and martyrs along the way, and then in the fullness of time, you sent Jesus the Christ to live as one of us. And in this Advent season, we especially give you thanks for your decision not to be God without us, but only to be God with us. We thank you for the birth of Jesus the Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. And we thank you that in his ministry he broke bread with sinners and outcasts and called all to the journey of peace with him. We thank you that he was obedient, and obedient even to the cross. And so in this meal, we do remember his sacrifice. And we ask that the Holy Spirit might be upon these elements here and upon the elements at each worshiper's home. And that your Holy Spirit might be upon those who share in this bread and in this cup. This morning we do pray the prayers that have been lifted. We pray for Dave Dougherty and for Louise Derflinger, for Sally Hooper and Laura Meyer, for Martha Rapp and Shirley Ryan, for Becky Smith, for Chris Winninger, for Marge and Bill Winfield, and for Marilyn and Don Winninger. We pray for our congregation, and we pray for Brian Leach Hudson. We pray for our military and their families, and our AmeriCorps and Peace Corps workers and their families. And we pray for our entire world as we continue to navigate the COVID-19 pandemic. We pray all of these things in Christ, through Christ, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My dear friends, on the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus took bread, and after he had broken it, after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, This is my body, broken for you. And in the same way, he took the cup, and he said, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you eat of this bread or drink of this cup, you do declare the Lord's life and death and resurrection until he comes again. Come now, the joyful feast of the people of God has now begun.
Thank you.
Let us now pray the prayer that is printed on your screens or in your bulletin. Thank you for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. May we go and do likewise in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us now go from this place, being surprised by our God, even in the mystery of not knowing when God's peace will come to us. May we be surprised. May we go from this place in the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the compassion of the Holy Spirit, both now and forevermore. Amen, and go in peace.